Welcome back, friends. And today, I am Dr. Mlelwa. I'm going to facilitate this lecture, teaching you about the chemical body. So, today, I start a new topic in chemistry, which is chemical bonding. So now, what is chemical bonding? So firstly, I just want to give you a concept about chemical bonding. So, in short and brief explanation, that atoms, they can exist as a single atom, but also they can exist in a combined form. So, why atoms combine? They need for the atoms to combine in order to become stable. So, the process by which the atoms, they combine together to form a stable compound is what we call the chemical bonding. And what combines or what joins between two atoms to form a compound or a molecule is what we call a bond. So now, bond is like a glue which joins two or more atoms to form what we call a molecule or a compound. And bonding is the process of putting that glue. Bonding is the process of putting what connects them and gives them stability. So that's all about chemical bonding. I know you have some of the concept of the chemical bonding from your Form 2 chemistry. However, I think maybe some of you didn't study chemical bonding in Form 2. So it doesn't matter. Let's go together, and I hope you will understand about chemical bonding. More of the concepts, they are new, they are not as Form 2. But this is one among the simplest topic, and you can just understand it and pass these questions in the exams and increase your performance. It's one among the topics which have 10 marks in your final exam. So let's go together. So by definition, these notes which I'm using, they in my Telegram group, so I will put the link in the description, and then you can join the group, and then you will find these notes there in my Telegram group for general chemistry. So by definition, chemical bonding is the chemical combination of two or more atoms to form a compound. Chemical combination of two or more atoms to form a compound. As I told you, that chemical bonding is just like putting a glue between atoms. So let's say we have two atoms. Say we have atom A, then we are plusing atom B, and then we are going to get atom A, B. Or in other words, let's say this atom A, B, we call it as atom C. So this combination of A plus B to get atom C is what we can call as the chemical bonding. So here between A and B means there should be something which connect them. So let's say we have A plus B. If firstly A were independent and B were independent, forming C means that you are taking A and B, and then you are putting something like a glue between them. And this is what we can call the chemical bond. So this is what holds A and B together. And now we can say that A and B, when they are together, they are called the compound C or the molecule C, because when the elements they are joining, two or more elements, when they are joining together, they can form a molecule or they can form a compound. So that's a short description about the chemical bond. So atoms can gain stability either by donating, gaining, or sharing the electrons. And also, I think you have this knowledge from your Form 2. But if you don't remember that these atoms, when they are joining together, I told you before that atoms, they join together in order to gain stability, in order to become stable. So these atoms, when they are joining together, they can join or they can gain stability through three methods. The first one is by losing electrons. So losing electrons is done by the elements known as metals. So metals always, they lose electrons when forming the chemical bond. Why? By gaining electrons is done by the non-metals. Non-metals always, they gain electron during chemical bonding. Gaining of electrons, gaining electrons. This is done by the non-metals. But also, non-metals, they cannot, sometimes they don't gain electrons, but they share electrons. So maybe one non-metal has an outermost shell with one electron, and another non-metal has an outermost shell with one electron, and then they share electron. So maybe in simple language, we can say that they share what they have. They share small things they have so as to sustain their life. Yani kwa lugha ambayo ni ya Kiswahili tungesema wana share umaskini. What small thing they have, they share so as to reach someone. So the third method of gaining stability is by sharing of electrons. Sharing of electrons. This is done by the non-metals. So metals, they cannot combine by this method of sharing electrons. Most of the non-metals, they are the ones which are combined by this method of sharing electrons. So having these three methods led to different types of chemical bondings. And due to these different methods of gaining stability, this will lead to the process that even the stability of the bonds will be different because of the difference in the process of the gaining that stability. So we can say that the electrons which can be donated or shared are those which are found in the valence shell. So all of these are taking place in the valence shell. In bonding, you must remember and you must know about the concept of valence shell. Because if you don't know about the concept of valence shell, it will be very difficult for you to understand most of the things in chemical bonding. So when we are saying valence shell, what is a valence shell? Simply, valence shell is the outermost shell. When we are saying about the valence shell, valence shell, this is the outermost shell. So for any given element, when we are saying about the valence shell is simply the outermost shell. So this outermost shell differs from element to element. Some of the elements, they have one, two, other they have three, other four. And they differ in number in the valence shell, as you know. And the number of electrons in the valence shell simply determines or shows the group of the element in that valence shell. So simply, if the element has one electron in the valence shell, it simply means that that element is group one. Say sodium or potassium, they have one electron in the outermost shell. Calcium, they have two electrons in the outermost shell, and etc., depending on your element. So the property of these electrons, mostly that if the valence shell has few electrons, like metals such as sodium or potassium, or calcium, they always lose that electron and they give to the element C with the valence shell with many electrons. Because in gaining stability, we have two states. We have a state in which we can have two electrons in the outermost shell, or we may have a state in which we may have eight electrons in the outermost shell. So in the state that we have two electrons in the outermost shell, if the valence shell of a metal has one electron, it donates to an element in the valence shell with one electron, and then they share the electrons. So it be and then the metal donates an electron to the non-metal with the one electron in the outermost shell. So the non-metal with the one electron in the outermost shell will have two electrons after gaining the electron. And then the metal, because it has one electron in the outermost shell, after donating that one electron, will remain with the eight electrons in the outermost shell. And for the sake of for the non-metals, which have maybe one electron in the outermost shell, they can share that one electron with each other, and then we can end up with the two, we can end up with the two atoms of the same element forming a molecule when they share that electron, and that will be the chemical bonding by sharing. So simply valence sharing in the outermost shell, and the gained electrons are accommodated in the valence shell of the sufficient atom. The pairs of the outermost electrons not used in the bonding are called the lone pair. So here in this part of introduction, you must know about these, some of the concepts which we have discussed, about the concept of chemical bonding, and then about the concept of the methods of the formation of the chemical bonding. And from there, you must know about the concept of the valence shell. And lastly is about the concept of lone pair. Now, what is lone pair? Lone pair. So simply, we can define lone pair in the pair of electron, which is the pair of valence electrons, which are not used in the normal covalent bond formation. In the pair of valence electrons, in the pair of valence electrons, which is or are not used in the normal covalent bond. So during the formation of the covalent bond in normal circumstance, during the formation of the covalent bond, in every element, we have some of the electrons which are commonly used. So some of the electrons, they are not commonly used, and that those electrons, they are called lone pair. So say, for example, is fluorine. Let's take fluorine as an example. So fluorine has 7 electrons in the outermost shell. So saying that it has 7 electrons, and let's say now fluorine has formed a bond with a certain element, saying hydrogen. So maybe we have taken fluorine plus hydrogen to get it. Maybe fluorine gas plus hydrogen gas to get it. Hydrogen fluoride. So if fluorine has combined with hydrogen, this bond is formed by just a sharing of electron. Hydrogen has 1 electron in the outermost shell. Fluorine has 7 electrons in the outermost shell. But among the 7 electrons, the bond is just only done by the sharing of the 1 electron in the outermost shell. So 6 electrons are not used. Among the 7 outermost electrons of the fluorine, only 1 electron is shared with the hydrogen to form a covalent bond. But the 6 electrons in the fluorine, they are not used. So because they are 6, and then lone pair, we are counting electron in pairs. So saying they are 6 electrons, we are dividing by 2, and then you get 3 pairs. So fluorine will have 3 lone pair, and even chlorine, the group 7 elements will have 3 lone pair. So I don't just tell you to claim group 7 element will have 3 lone pair, group 6 element will have 2 lone pair, group 5 element will have 1 lone pair, group 4 element they have no lone pair, because all of the outermost electrons they used in bonding. And then from there, from group 3, group 2 and group 1, they are metals. So metals, they don't have lone pairs. Lone pairs exist only in nonmetals, because they just use only few of the outermost electrons in chemical bonding, and the other of the outermost electrons, they are not used in chemical bonding. And considering nonmetal, they have many electrons in their outermost electrons as compared to the metals, and that's why the lone pair exists in nonmetals. So when you are studying and when you are trying to learn and understand the concept of lone pair, just delete the concept that lone pair exists in metals or exists in group 1, group 2, group 3, and group 4 elements. So just start to remember that the group 5 element will have one lone pair. Group 5 element like nitrogen will have one lone pair. And then group 6 elements such as sulfur and oxygen will have two lone pair. And then group 7 element like chlorine and fluorine will have three lone pairs. And then from there, now we can jump to say that we have bonding is possible between a certain kind of metals. So bonding can occur between a metal and a non-metal, and bonding can occur between two or more non-metallic atoms. Now remember here, a bond cannot occur between a metal and a metal. Can occur between two nanometals or two nanometallic atoms and between a metal and a nanometal. That's why I told you before that the sharing of electron is possible only in the nanometals, but not in the metals. So metals require losing of electrons. They must lose an electron. And if they lose an electron, they must form a bond with element which receive the lost electrons from the metals. And that element should be non-metal or non-metallic element. So there is no possible bond between two metals. That is the thing that you should remember in your head. So when drawing the arrangement of the atom in a molecule, we dot the electron from one of the atom and across for the electrons from the atom. The outer electrons are drawn in a pair to emphasize the number of bond pair and number of pairs. So this I will just demonstrate it in the next lecture, these informations, and I'm sure you can understand them as far as I will be explaining them with the illustrations. So next lecture we shall start on the types of chemical bonding, and we shall discuss about the covalent bonds, their types and different categories and classification of the covalent bonds. So thank you everybody for listening to me. Subscribe to the channel, like the video, share it, and don't forget to comment anything. If you don't understand, comment and then I will answer your questions and I will be considering your suggestions. Don't forget to join my Telegram group for these notes. You can find them in the soft copy for your more understanding and reference. Thank you, everybody. And I wish you nice studies. Thank you.